Welcome to the Spokane Valley Fire Department Board of Commissioners meeting for November 9th, 2020, starting at 4 p.m. We'll call to order and we will start with the Pledge of Allegiance led by Commissioner Mike Kester. Commissioner.
I pledge allegiance to the flag, the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mike. Very much appreciated. Roll call, let the record reflect. We have four of the five board members here. Commissioner Birch will try to join us if he can. He's had technical difficulties at his end, not at the end of our IT department, but at his end, and he'll try to join us if he can. But I would ask the board if he doesn't, if we can excuse his absence at the next meeting.
So moved, Bill.
Thank you. Yeah, that would be nice, Bill. John, was that a second?
Yes, second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
And if he can, he's going to try to jump in. But again, technical difficulties at his end, and he definitely apologizes, trying to figure it out. We have a special presentation, which will begin right now. It's the final public hearing on our 2020 budget presentation. And this is the second of two. And we will begin this public hearing at 5:01 p.m. And Chief, I'll turn it over to you to introduce Angela, and if you want to make a few comments.
Yeah. So thank you, members of the board. The version of the budget that you have before you tonight is the same version that you saw 2 weeks ago at our first public hearing, and really hadn't changed much in the last month or two as we've been developing this budget. You guys have seen it both at the Finance Committee level and the board level several times now. So with that, we'll go through the presentation one more time, and Angela can fill in any details and answer any questions you have. And then tonight, we're looking for final approval of the budget and accompanying resolutions from the board. So go ahead, Angela.
Good afternoon.
You're fine, Angela.
Yeah, I'm clicking on the right. There you go. Okay. The computer's moving on its own. There you go. Mm-hmm. Okay. So tonight we'll be presenting the 2021 proposed budget. And as Chief mentioned, it looks same as last time, so 2 weeks ago. So on the proposed revenue, we have $45.8 million in property taxes, less $1.35 million for the tax increment financing and uncollected taxes. This is where we're taking the 2% reduction for property tax collections that we're estimating to have next year. We have $130,000 for fire protection and mobilizations. We have $126,000 for fire prevention fees, $24,000 for shop repair charges. We do some warranty work for some of the outland or outside fire districts. The ambulance contract administration, investment earnings, and other revenues. So it's about $45 million for the year. We're estimating our regular tax levy to be about $1.15 per thousand, and the special levy to be $1.73 per thousand. That will be a total of $2.89 per $1,000 of assessed value. And these levy rates were based on 3% assessed value changes. And then the tax increment financing was renewed for up to five more years for 2021 through 2025. And one of the projects is the Henry Road overpass. I believe there was an article in the paper about that just over the last week or so. And then we are just requesting the board to adopt a property tax increase for the regular property taxes of 0.602%, which is the implicit price deflator. So on the expenditure side, we have wages and benefits estimated to be $34.7 million. Supplies and services are about $5.4 million. Capital at $6.7 million. $1.5 million for the pension fund transfer for our left one retirees. And then 1% of our M&O budget or non-capital budget of $430,000. So at this time, we have a 2.5% overall increase for wages and benefits. Labor and industry rates are still unknown. We usually get those about mid-December. In the capital, we have maintenance facility and the annex construction budgeted for 2021. That was originally supposed to start in 2020, but was deferred due to the property tax reductions. There was little to no increase in supplies and services other than mandatory expenses like contract increases. We have certain products that we can't get by without. So if they raise their prices, we have to pay those increased costs. We plan to purchase 2 staff vehicles, payment on the tiller, a new engine, plus the associated equipment. And then, ongoing replacement of some extrication equipment, thermal imaging cameras, and defibrillators. So that makes up the majority of those. So on our estimated funding balance, we're estimating to end 2020 with about $17 million in our fund balance. We're projecting $44,997,000 of revenues, about $48.8 million of expenses, which will end the year with about a $13.3 million fund balance. That fund balance would be broken down into designated reserves of $11.2 million. The majority of that is the 25% that the board sets aside for cash flow purposes and emergencies. And then we have undesignated reserves. We have like $650,000 because we're self-insured. And then we have so that it would just be cash. So what this chart shows is the 2019 budget versus 2019 actual expenditures, the 2020 budget, 2021 budget, 22 and 23. So as you can see, the 2019 budget, the blue is the wages and benefits, the orange are supplies and services, the gray is capital, the yellow is the contingency, the 1%, and then the green is the pension transfer. So for 2019, our expenditures came in a little bit higher on wages and benefits, and don't recall, I think that was due to mobilization. I'd have to look at that. Our supplies and services came in low. Our capital came in low. We had, I think, an engine purchase and it wasn't delivered till 2020. So that was the difference there. And then we only transferred $1 million to the pension fund. So, and then 2020 budget, this is kind of the breakdown, how the budget looks right now. 2021, the capital goes from 4.9 to 6.7. The majority of that is the maintenance facility annex that was included in 2020. It's still included in this number, but we won't pay it until 2021. And then 2022, have projections, some capital increases, and then 3% for supplies and services. On our medical fund budget, we're estimating to end this year with about $3 million in reserves. We're projecting to receive about $4.1 million in revenue. Those revenues are the premiums that the department and the employee pays, plus a little bit of interest earnings, and then the projected expenses are about $4.2 million. So that we're estimating to end the year with 2.866 in reserves. And as we mentioned 2 weeks ago, we are not taking a premium increase. We have sufficient reserves to carry the fund without an increase. And on the pension fund, we're estimating to end this year with about $1.5 million. will have projected revenues of $1.7 million. The majority of that is the $1.5 million transfer from the general fund. We also have some interest earnings and fire insurance premium taxes that we receive. And then expenses are projected to be about $1.7 million, and those are medical costs and a little bit of pension costs for our left lung retirees. So we're estimating to end the year with about $1.6 million. Are there any questions? A lot more brief this time than last time.
Question from the board members?
Not for me.
Hearing none, Angela, thank you. Okay, any other comments from the board members concerning the final public hearing for the budget 2021 and beyond? Seeing none, we will close the public hearing at 5:11 p.m. and we will move forward with the rest of our agenda. We'll start with department reports. Prevention quarterly report. And I would ask that you give us about 20 seconds before you start. So we have to scroll down on our packet. This packet is quite a long packet. So we'll scroll down to those reports and we'll be ready. So I think we're ready. Chief Rogers.
Thank you, sir. Hope you can hear me.
Hear you very well.
Thank you. The prevention report starts out with just letting you know we're doing some data scrubbing in regards to our property data information, which was presented in the first paragraph there. There were the inspectors, a couple of the inspectors are going through and data scrubbing a lot of our property data information. So we're utilizing this time and opportunity to go through and make sure we're identifying the right suppression systems in the right buildings. One of the reasons why this is important as IS transfers over into the new MDCs, that information is going to be available to everybody out in the field that's responding to those facilities. So we're utilizing this opportunity to make sure that that information in our system is accurate. One of the other things we're doing is our community risk reduction specialist is working in regards to the community risk assessment and the SOC in regards to identifying some demographic capabilities where we might use that force incorporating into our community risk assessment in regards to our scoring opportunities. Another program that we're working on is our apartment managers program. We launched this program about 2 years ago and we did a couple of in-person classes. Unfortunately, due to COVID and where we are today, the nice thing is with Julie Community Affairs and Mary, we're going to take that online and we're actually going to provide that same level of class, but we're going to have each speaker do that in about 45 minute components, video recorded components. And then at the end of the class, those apartment managers and apartment maintenance individuals will be able to take a test. The test is based upon all the different components in the class. Once they take that test, the individuals and complex will actually, or we're planning on having them receive a certificate from us that they're a fire safe apartment complex based upon the class that they've taken from us. And it's kind of like our accreditation model. The certification will be valid for 3 years. So that way it will require them to come back and for us to be able to update them with that information. Also in your packet is a photo of a fire prevention trailer or a community event trailer that we had wrapped. We actually got that wrapped by CW Wraps, actually donated that to the department. So it was somewhere in between about $4,000 and $6,000 donation that they donated for the entire wrap for that trailer. And we're hoping to use that as our community event trailer when we get back into that capability. We also did Fire Prevention Week. We're also working on older adult fall prevention program, as well as our school program refresher. One of the big projects that our community risk reduction specialist did is our school program. Our school program used to be the Edith House, went out to every school with the fire engine, visited that. We've actually shifted gears completely and we've gone to a new program. And it's all online. It's a nationally recognized program that's called Sound Off with Fire Safety Patrol. And we've also utilized the opportunity to have a couple of individuals read some books. They're firefighters in our department, or different members in our department read these books and incorporate that into the program. So it's been very easy for us to incorporate that into that program. The other thing that you'll see is our income due to permit fees. You can see it's at, we're right at $130,000. This is through September. We're expecting one more quarter. This is about, I think this is about $5,000 more than what we finished all of last year with. The other years that you see marked there are the same years through, or the same value through this time of those years. The other piece that I wanted to share with you was our illegal burn response down at the next page down, which is an indication. This is the illegal burns that we've responded to. So far this year, we've responded to 355, which is the most that we've responded to since I've been here over the last 5 years. The interesting thing is as we worked with GIS, Drew and IS in the mapping, we mapped this out. And it's interesting when you look at the 2020 calls, you think it would be more out in our rural area, and it's not. It's more in our populated area, in the city area, matter of fact. So we're trying to provide some other educational opportunities to deal with that. The last piece is because we've kind of changed our report up a little bit. I wanted to include in our quarterly report a significant incident that we responded to. And one of the ones was recently with a teen that we had, a 15-year-old, in regards to an arson fire that we had. And we're still in the investigation phase and working with the sheriff's office and the DA's office. I can say this is probably the first major incident in quite some time that we've had, and shows our ability and our partnership that we have with the sheriff's office. They helped us tremendously in this effort, and it's a great, I just want to give a big shout out for the sheriff's office and their forensic unit. They also were able to come in and utilize their 3D cameras and do a 3D image of the entire facility. So that's all of my report, unless you have any questions.
Commissioners have questions. I have a quick question on the fall prevention. How do you work with the assisted living facilities in the Valley? Do they have an organization you can go to and talk about how to evaluate fall protection in assisted living, those types of facilities?
Yeah, there was a state coalition through the health district. Unfortunately, the local health district employee is no longer there, and it's not the doctor that has since been left. It was a different employee, but their state coalition is kind of, because they're no longer, that individual is no longer employed and they're not going to have that position. So one of the things I'm working with Caroline on is we're going to step in and try to take over for that coalition. And make it a local coalition here for Spokane Valley. And that will help correlate and be and help us facilitate getting into those facilities.
Well, it's evident by your report, you guys have been busy. Every time you come, I think one or more commissioners will say that you've been busy. It's never going to end. You guys keep adding new programs and doing great things for the Valley. So I want to thank you on behalf of the board for some pretty neat programs, especially trying to tap into the schools now. A little bit easier before, now it's more difficult. Teachers feeling a little more stress. You're taking some of that stress away by giving them the materials in hand. So thank you.
Absolutely.
Okay. Let's move on to Community Affairs Quarterly Report. I'm sorry, Mr. Kester, you're on mute.
That doesn't help. How's that? I just want to comment. I want to comment, Mr. Rogers, on the wrap they put on that trailer. It really looked sharp and it's an eye catcher. That was a job well done.
And I forgot to mention on the wrap, if you want to see the trailer, it's parked there at admin.
Yeah, I did see it the other day. It looks really nice.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move on now to Community Affairs Quarterly Report. We go from one busy report to another busy report with Julie Happy and her staff, Mary, and you guys are very busy, so we look forward to this report.
Thank you. Hope you can hear me.
Yes.
Perfect. So I wanted to start off real quick with our regularly scheduled spokesman, our news coverage report that we do each week. That's featured on Thursdays. This has produced some really great stories for us, including when our new chaplain came on board just a few weeks ago when we had the big windstorm, and they talked about the number of calls that we went on that day. They, of course, followed us with the burn restrictions being lifted, and then just recently they did the local 876's coat drive, as well as all the calls that happened throughout the week. We really appreciate the spokesman giving us this opportunity to highlight all the calls that are happening in our area week by week. So that's a big deal. And I really am happy for that. And then just moving on to social media. Social media has been performing really well for us. And I'm happy to see that during COVID, our aggregate of minutes viewed are up, our 1 minute video views are up, 3 second video views are looking good, and just our engagement is going very well. Our top performing videos, of course, are Fire Science Friday, Medic Monday, and I put on there the Fire Board of Commissioner meetings just for fun, since those are relatively new to us. And if you look down, I showed about 5 weeks worth of meetings, and last week, your special meeting performed very well with 707 minutes viewed. We had been seeing in that 300 to 400 minute viewed. So that was nice to see that increase. 820, I don't remember what that meeting was, but that also was a highly viewed meeting. And I think this is a really great opportunity for our community to see what we're doing. And I think it shows a big success over what we were doing with just the in-person meeting. So I'm finding I really like this format. And I'm really grateful to Joseph and his IS team for making this happen for us during this time of COVID. And then I wanted to thank Greg and his team for all the materials they helped us with to do a successful fire prevention week. Those fire prevention week videos saw on average 350 minutes viewed on Facebook every day. That doesn't count or take into account all the other social media platforms we were running things on, or all the other engagement things we were utilizing, such as graphics and any other platforms or information we received to share as well. I also want to share Chief and Ryan Van Way's letter 8 video is performing very well on social media. When it first came out, it was a little slow and I was kind of concerned, but it is steadily increasing with the number of people it's reaching. I think when I put this report out, it was about 600. Currently, it's up to 800, which is about 1 week later. And then the AR video we put out this weekend has performed incredibly well with a reach of about 1,300 people. So we're really happy with these programs and just showing those levy dollars in action. We're now on Nextdoor, and that's really fun. It's a different platform, and we're being received very well. There are 130 neighborhoods in our fire district, 22,216 members, and that's approximately 31% of those close to 56,000 households signed up on Nextdoor in our fire district. Medic Monday with R.W. Pagow just has had an amazing outcome being on Nextdoor. And we'll be doing a follow-up video with our dub now that he's back, with the woman whose life was positively affected because of one of Paramedic Pagow's Medic Monday. Because of all the success we're seeing on social media, we get a lot of people asking us to pick up other social media platforms. And so TikTok and Pinterest are some platforms we've been asked to pursue, and I'll review those in 2021. currently, I'm not sure Mary and I have the capacity to take on these two new platforms and manage them well. So we're gonna have to look at that before we consider it. I think TikTok would be a fun venue. I just really need to make sure we can handle that. Our educational videos and PSAs, we're working on our 2021 calendar currently. Mary and I are running out of production capacity. What Mary and I can dream of, and with all that everybody helps suggest, all these additional requests, we are maxed out. And with Fire Prevention Week, we learned real quick what our maximum is. And so we want to make sure we keep some balance. And just to share kind of what our regular monthly program looks like, we have a chief's message we try to share each month, a fire science variety, a medic Monday. We have a community risk reduction message we share, and then of course your commissioner meetings. And then we also try to keep up on some regular graphics, including those monthly calls for service, 911 Monday. We really like this while you were sleeping. Chief is the one who suggested that. He saw it, I believe, in San Francisco or somewhere, where we can highlight the calls we went on while, you know, the night prior. And I want to again thank the IS team for helping develop a program where I can quickly look and see what we did overnight. Also, the national days we celebrate, we have Veterans Day coming up. So that's another graphic. And any graphic that represents any trends we're seeing in calls for service, like driving without your lights on, illegal burning, the cooking fires. A few weeks ago, we saw burning food was a big call we were going on. Cigarette fires and end of life alarms, of course. Any trends I see as I look through the weekly calls we had the prior week, as I'm compiling my report for the spokesman, as I was doing that today, I saw we went on a lot of water calls where pipes were running, and we went on a lot of calls where dust or construction was setting off smoke alarms. And then of course we had two cat rescues. So those are just fun things we see. And then we try to make a graphic or some kind of educational opportunity. Going into 2021, we're kind of looking at our communication direction. One of which will be, of course, that website update we've been talking about. And then our communication plan, Mary and I will review that production capability month to month, determine some priorities, and then being able to manage those other asks that come in. I think the videos are doing very well and people are noticing that, and they want to see more of that. So they have lots of suggestions and we really like that. We're going to review our PIO structure and process. We're doing a lot of things right with that. And conversely, we have a lot of room for improvement as well. And so we're going to, 2021, we will look at how we can minimize some of those things we miss and kind of maximize our opportunities. You should see some good things resulting from this. I follow Los Angeles Fire Department, and they have a really cool program they're doing where they take a video of their fires and some of the stills, and they compile them and they create a video and they turn it around in a tight time frame, and their PIO kind of narrates what's happening in that fire, and then they put it out for the public to see within a day or two after. And I think that's kind of an important video that we could do fairly easily and just show and demonstrate some of the great work we're doing. Mary's capacity is about one small video per week, about that 3 to 5 minutes, and then some of the and then one of those longer videos for the month. So we're trying to put out about 4 videos per month, and sometimes one more if it's a longer one. And then along with all our regular social media graphics. And for 2021, we are creating a monthly plan when kind of all of those videos and graphics kind of tie together, and we can tie them back to our strategic and capital plans, accreditation, and kind of that levy dollar in action look. And then of course reviewing TikTok and Pinterest. And then our monthly newsletters will continue each quarter. So we are very busy and we're very happy. I think there's some good things coming out of the community affairs department. Any questions?
Okay. Questions from the commissioners. Commissioner Kester.
Yeah, Julie, I have a question for you. Who's taking those videos? Is that from the news media, or do they have their own photographer that's doing this? Because a lot of times there isn't somebody there on these situations to actually film it, is there?
Oh, for Los Angeles Fire Department, the PIO takes them. I know somewhere like a head camera on those GoPros, and then you just kind of go through and just take a little segment of that camera, not the whole, of course, not the whole video.
Okay.
But the PIOs, if they're, you know, dispatched for an 11W, they have the opportunity to take some footage as well.
Right. Okay, thank you.
Other questions from the commissioners? Comments? Julie, I have a couple of comments. One, I'm extremely impressed with your report. You guys are very busy. I would encourage you to go slowly with social media. Don't overwhelm yourself because there are two of you. And as you, and it was a candid statement. You made a couple of candid statements in there, which I appreciate. You know, we're running as fast as we can. We don't know if we can run faster. I think taking a good steady pace, moving us forward, you guys are doing a phenomenal job. So don't burn yourselves out early. Get in a good pace and stick with it. That would be my amateurish recommendation. Don't, because you guys, you know, reading Greg's report and then reading your report, I was tired reading them. I thought, wow, where do they find the time to do this? And then Angela throws in hers, and I'm thinking, wow, this is pretty amazing. So very impressive stuff. I'm also excited about the views for the commissioners meetings. I know we're not going to have as many people as Saturday Night Live. We're working toward it. It's going to take some time. But one of the criticisms we have had over the years is we can't get anybody to come into our building to the meetings. So we might have one or two patrons, if that. It was mostly staff. So this has changed that, and I'm excited because of technology, because of Zoom, we're now better connecting with our community members. So I want to thank you for the help of COVID-19, of course, getting us on Zoom and our IT department, making it run smoothly. And we'll get better. We're not skilled professionals yet, but we'll get better with our dialogue and perhaps our video presentations, et cetera, from our standpoint, not our IT department, of course. My hair might not be messed up at a time, but I just want to thank you. I think people don't realize what's going on. I think due to COVID-19, our staff is working so hard, and many are working from home. Many are in the field working. So simply stated, thank you. You guys are doing a phenomenal job, and I think the public relations group you're working, you and Mary, are doing a stellar job. So thank you. Other thoughts, questions? Okay, moving on to October 2020 financial report, more dollar news.
More numbers, very exciting. So now I have the monthly report as of October 31st, 2020. We were 83% of the way through the year. Our revenues were at 58.43% compared to 60.47% at this time last year. So we're down 2%, and that was mostly due to property taxes. And those were the actual receipts that collect the property taxes that the treasurer's office received in September and then distributed to us in October. And then our expenses are at 74.4% versus 80.3% last year. So as you can see, we've been watching our spending during this time of uncertainty. Our salaries are down about 5%, and then our M&O is down also a little bit. On the pension fund, we're at 73 on the revenue side, 73.55% compared to 74.16%, so fairly comparable to last year. Expenses were at 71.52% compared to 71.79%, so those are also looking good. In the medical fund, our revenues are at 81% compared to 80.8%, and the expenses were at 69.2% compared to 74.8%. So on the medical fund, our medical claims are down a little bit so far this year, but overall we're looking pretty good considering. Are there any questions on this?
Questions. Thank you, Angela. Nice job. You've been busy. Moving on to So I scroll back up. Finance revenue update.
What?
You just did the finance revenue update?
That was some, yeah. This
I can't hear you. Yeah, I can't hear anything. Am I locked out? Oh, no, you're on, Angela.
Okay. Okay.
I lost everybody for a sec.
I'm sorry. So this is showing what our property tax collections were for November 1st through November 8th. So far this month, we've received Treasurer's Office has received $448,217.52 for the first week of November. So on an annual basis, we're only a week through October, November, but we're about 88%. And typically we've received really close to 100%. Last year, we actually received a little bit more than 100% because there was a refund levy that we did not count in our projections when we did the budget adoption, but we're down about 13% right now, but we're only 1 week into November and the taxpayers have until the end of the year to pay their second half property taxes without interest or penalties. So we're hopeful that our October collections were at 87% and they were down just slightly, about 2% from last year. So when we look at October versus April, we're staying about the same. So we're hopeful that we'll end up at the 2% reduction again this year, but we'll be getting weekly updates through the end of the year and we'll keep the board updated on those. Are there any questions on the property taxes?
I appreciate those regular updates. Thoughts from the commissioners, questions for Angela? Seeing none, thank you, Angela. Very much appreciate it. And let's move on to number five, October 2020, response totals.
Good evening, commissioners. In your packet, you'll see that for the month of October, we had almost 1,700 calls for service, 1,683. You'll note an EMS is running where we would expect that at about 82.5% of those total calls. But just to give you a perspective on how that breaks down a little bit further, for advanced life support, we're running at about 56% of those EMS calls. And then for our basic life support, we're running about 44%. We've watched this trend over the past few years of our ALS calls starting to come up. So it's very timely for the addition of the second ARU to absorb some of those lower acuity calls. We've had that in service for about a week now, so we'll be monitoring the numbers and getting back to you with reports on that status. But so far, it's been a good transition. A lot of folks helped get that new unit in service, particularly the crews that are on duty that day. A lot of moving pieces, HR doing staffing changes, the shop helping get the equipment set up, and so on. So there's so many people to thank. I won't take up much time here, but know that it was a very collaborative team effort to get this new unit in service. Although we're only up about 1.45% for the year, October was the busiest October we've had in a number of years. The crews responded to about 9% more calls in the month of October. So in addition to all the other things that are going on, crews continue to respond at a high level. We're getting a lot of compliments from the community on the customer service that they provide, and they're doing it with an increased call volume. So busy all the way around the department and a lot of good work going on. Any questions with the other numbers in the report?
Questions? Okay, thank you, Sean, very much. I appreciate that report. We'll move on to public comment. Public comment, since we're on Zoom and using the new tools of technology, we will take public comment until 2 o'clock of the day of the meeting. And at this time, I don't believe we have any public comment recorded and sent forward. But I would encourage if you have comments, thoughts, please contact www.SpokaneValleyFire.com and leave your thoughts and or comments on that site and they'll get to the commissioners and or administration for thoughts and responses. So we welcome anyone to do that. again, 2 o'clock prior to the day of the meeting, we would ask that you get those in so we can get those sent forward. Next on the agenda is the approval of the consent agenda. Consent agenda consists of items considered routine, which are approved by a single motion. A board member may remove any item from the consent agenda to be considered separately. Are there any commissioners who wish to remove an item to be considered separately? Seeing none, we'll move forward. Approval of minutes, October 26, 2020, instead of 19, I believe. That's a typo. Approval of vouchers, number 259634 through 259639 in the amount of $3,826.02. 35 vouchers in the amount of $119,227.69. 19 EFTs in the amount of $503,719.45. 33 EFTs in the amount of $31,700.80. UHC wire transfer in the amount of $32,218.80. Approval of October payroll in the amount of $1,485,724.87. Commissioner meeting approval, Spokane Valley Fire Commissioner Association Zoom meeting this Thursday, November 12th, 2020, 7 o'clock p.m. And that again is the Spokane Valley or Spokane Area Fire Commissioners meeting. And with that, the chair would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I will move to approve the consent agenda.
Thank you, Commissioner Anderson. Is there a second?
Second.
Commissioner Grisco, thank you. There's a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Motion passes. Administration report, Marks, Chief. Not on the agenda, but we'd be happy to add you to the agenda.
No remarks tonight. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Chief. Commissioner remarks. Let's start with Commissioner Anderson.
I have nothing tonight. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Mr. Grisco.
I just want to thank everybody for the reports tonight. Angela, Greg, Sean, Julie, everybody's working really hard and I really appreciate everybody. What's going on? It feels like we're wrapping up the year with a lot of reports. This is nice. I also was able to run down just a little sidebar down Barker. I didn't realize it was open. Saw our sign out there for future station 11. Looks really good. So good job on getting that out there. Unfortunately, nobody knows that Barker's open. So got to make sure people can go by our sign. I think they're still think it's closed. So that's all I have, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kester.
Yeah, I have a question for Brian. How are we looking on the COVID front as far as our first responders?
Yeah, we continue to have positive tests trickle in. Chief Arrow notified me tonight of another. I think we have about three, potentially four right now that are out with either positive or symptoms of COVID. So we continue. I think all in all, based on the number of exposures that our personnel have on a regular basis, or potential exposures, I should say, that the suppression side guys are doing a good job of, staying healthy. We have, probably picked up now in the neighborhood of about 12 cases or so since this started, which is not bad considering, the number of medical emergencies and also considering the trend and what's going on in the general population in our area.
Very good.
Okay. Other thoughts or questions? I have just a couple. At our next meeting for the consent agenda, we will be adding for your consideration two work sessions in December. Both of those work sessions will be for the board working on policy review. And so I'm going to be calling and working with individual commissioners this week to pick selected dates and or times that best meet their needs. And then, like they say, herding cats, I'll bring all that information together and we'll establish those dates for December. There'll be two of those. And then at the next meeting, we will also have on the consent agenda a request not to have our meeting in the end of December, which is historically we haven't held a meeting, second meeting of December because of the Christmas holiday. So that will be on the agenda. Those are just FYIs for the future consent agenda. Then I would just want to give a shout out. People are working hard. Sometimes we forget about our chiefs, but Chief O'Brien has been doing a great job with our facilities. Kudos to his effort to keep looking at our facilities and moving those processes forward. So thank you for that. Staff reports are stellar as always. We appreciate it. That's all I can say. We appreciate what you do from the chiefs, firefighters, administrative staff. Everybody's working very hard. So we want to say thank you for that. And with that, that's the end of my report for commissioner reports. Now we're going to go into new business. We have several resolutions on the docket. So we will move through those one at a time. And we'll start with resolution 2020-475.
Commissioners, resolution 2020-475 is to certify to the county assessor a 0.602% increase to the district's 2021 regular tax levy. This is an increase of $106,499 that would be collected in the 2021 year. This is exclusive of additional revenue resulting from new construction, improvements to property, and any increase in the value of state assessed property. And staff is recommending that the board approve the IPD rate of 0.602%.
Okay, and board has had the opportunity to review that resolution as well as others. So the chair would entertain a motion to adopt resolution 2020-475 certifying to this county assessor a 0.602% increase to the district's 2021 regular tax levy.
Move.
Is there such a motion? There's a motion, Commissioner Anderson. Is there a second? Commissioner Kester, discussion. All those in favor, this time we will signify by saying yes or no for the record, please. So let's start with Commissioner Kester.
Yes.
Commissioner Grisco.
Aye.
Commissioner Anderson.
Yes.
Mr. Pearson is a yes. Okay, thank you very much. Moving on to resolution number 2020-476 in the matter of the adoption of the 2021 budget for the district general fund. Angela.
The staff is recommending that the Board of Commissioners adopt resolution 2020-476, which authorizes the 2021 general fund annual budget. And this budget includes all of the revenues and the expenses that we presented to you in the earlier presentation, as well as at the previous budget meeting.
Okay, chair would entertain a motion to adopt resolution 2020-476, approving the 2021 general budget.
So moved.
Okay, Commissioner Grisago, motion. Second.
Second.
Commissioner Anderson, discussion. Let's start with Commissioner Anderson, yay or nay?
Yay.
Yay. Commissioner Grisco.
Yay.
Commissioner Kester.
Yes.
Commissioner Pearson is yes. Moving on to resolution number 2020-477 in the matter of the adoption of the 2021 budget for the department's medical self-insurance fund. Angela.
The staff has recommended that the Board of Commissioners adopt resolution 2020-477. We're required to have an annual budget for the medical self-insurance fund. So this fund would have about $4.1 million in revenues and $4.2 million in expenditures, as shown in the earlier presentation.
Okay, thank you. The chair would entertain a motion to adopt resolution 2020-417 based on the attachments to adopt the 2021 budget for the department's medical self-insurance program.
Mr. Chairman, I would move adoption of resolution 2020-477.
Thank you, Commissioner Anderson. Is there a second? Commissioner Kester, second. Discussion. All those in favor, we'll start with Commissioner Grisco.
Aye.
Aye. Commissioner Anderson.
Aye.
Commissioner Kester.
Aye.
Commissioner Pearson. Aye. Motion passes. Moving on to resolution 2020-478 in the matter of the adoption of the 2021 budget for the department's pension fund. Angela.
Again, staff recommends that the Board of Commissioners adopt resolution 2020-478 authorizing the 2021 pension fund annual budget. This budget does include a allocation of $1.5 million from the general fund.
Thank you, Angela. The chair would entertain a motion to adopt resolution 2020-478, approving the 2021 budget for the department's pension fund. Motion to approve. Is there a motion?
I will move to approve resolution 2020-478.
Commissioner Grisco, move to approve. Second. Is there a second? Mr. Kester, second. Discussion. All those in favor, let's start with Commissioner Kester.
Aye.
Commissioner Anderson.
That affects me, so I have to abstain, right, I think.
Okay, that works. Commissioner Grisco.
Aye.
And Commissioner Pearson, we have a quorum, so that passes. Thank you very much. And moving on to approval to enter into an interlocal agreement with Spokane County Department of Emergency Medical Services for staff support at Spokane County Emergency Coordination Center. And this is Angela. Are you going to give that report, Angela?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. This is an interlocal with the Spokane County Emergency Community Coordination Center. And this is mainly for when Division Chief Charter and Captain Crawford did some NIMS work out at the ECC back in about March and April. And then it also reimburses the Valley Fire Department for use of the decon trailer out at the county fairgrounds earlier this year. And this is a reimbursement of about $33,408. This is paid by Spokane County's FEMA Public Assistance Program Fund.
Excellent. Thank you, Angela. The chair would entertain a motion to authorize Spokane Valley Fire Department to enter into an interlocal agreement with Spokane County Department of Emergency Management for staff support of the Spokane County Emergency Coordination Center. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Commissioner Anderson, thank you. Do I hear a second? Mr. Grisco, thank you. Discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor, we'll start with Commissioner Grisco.
Aye.
Commissioner Anderson.
Aye.
Commissioner Kester.
Aye.
Commissioner Pearson. Aye. Motion passes. Moving on. The many pages. We're on the grant approval to accept grant award from Spokane County CARES Act funding for the purchase of COVID compliant cardiac resuscitation equipment package. Who will?
Greetings, Commissioner. This is Mike Charter. Can you hear me?
Thank you, Mike. Yes, we can, Mike. Thank you very much.
I apologize for the lack of webcam. I live out in the sticks with satellite internet, so I either get video or audio, but not both. So, go ahead and give you an overview of this and give Angela a break for a few minutes. So Spokane County received CARES Act grant funding from the federal government, I believe around $70 million for the purposes of distributing to agencies and jurisdictions to mitigate the impacts of COVID and then for future preparation for subsequent COVID impacts or pandemics. So as part of that, Zoll Medical, which is one of two major cardiac monitor manufacturers, got a suite of COVID-approved equipment approved to be an authorized grant expenditure. They approached us knowing that we're getting to the close to the end of a serviceable life of our current fleet of physio control monitors, and asked us if we would be interested in pursuing funding for that. So Captain Baird really did all the legwork on this, got the ball rolling, and approached the county to get that funding for the Zoll products. And we have been offered $1.7 million from Spokane County for the purchase of Zoll medical equipment. So that would be a complete monitor, ECG 12 lead monitor replacement for all the apparatus. It would be AED replacements. It would also include new equipment to include their auto pulse automatic CPR device, similar to what I showed you last year, where we at the commissioner's meeting, and then out to the Spokane County commissioner's meeting in Newman Lake, where it automatically does CPR. It would include a fleet of those and a field ventilator designed to reduce aerosolization during resuscitation efforts. So that the first item is the agenda item to accept that grant award, which leads us to the subsequent 2020-479 resolution. So that grant award is attached to this item.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Charter. The board chair would entertain a motion to authorize Spokane Valley Fire Department to accept the CARES Act grant award from Spokane County in the amount of $1,700,000 for the purchase of cardiac resuscitation equipment manufactured by Zoll Medical.
Question. Motion?
Question. Let's have a motion first before we have a question. Mr. Kester, moved. Second?
Second.
Now discussion.
So,
Commissioner Grisco.
I think this is great, but I'm just kind of curious. So the county gets the CARES money. We applied for CARES money, correct?
Correct.
And then they approached us knowing we're getting the CARES money.
We weren't even aware of the pool of money until Zoll said, hey, there's money available and this COVID compliant set of equipment is an authorized purchase, knowing that we were looking at potential monitor replacement in the next couple of years. So that's what the request was. We could have requested money for anything, but this was a pre-built, pre-authorized package that the county would say, and the federal government would say, yes, that's an authorized CARES Act expenditure.
Okay. That makes sense. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, it was more of them making us aware that it was an option than steering us towards their product, but they did make us aware of the option. And it is a complete grant, so there is no award, there is no matching requirement with that for funding.
Is there, I guess, we'll get, I don't know if this is the time to bring this up, but is there other opportunity? They have 90 some plus million actually in CARES money, but not trying to get greedy, but are we going to need any more of that money?
I haven't explored it beyond the Zolls outside of my division. I'm unaware of anybody else in any other divisions in the department asking for money.
Okay, thank you.
It's a pretty substantial award. I've been in contact with several departments throughout the state that have gotten CARES Act funding for the exact same thing, purchase of Zoll equipment. And most of those awards were $100,000 or less. Mm-hmm. So through their respective city of Tacoma, a couple other places. So 1.7 is pretty big.
Yeah.
Okay. Chair, Commissioner Kester, question?
Well, no, just a comment that that's probably an excellent time for us to get that, since our other equipment is getting older and it's getting obsolete. So it couldn't have come at a better time.
Okay. Any further discussion before we vote? Okay, we'll start with Commissioner Kester.
Aye.
Commissioner Anderson.
Aye, with the kudos to Mike Charter and Dave Baird for their work on this and everybody else.
Okay. Commissioner Grisco.
Aye.
And Commissioner Pearson is an aye. Again, thanking those two and others, Captain Baird and Chief Charter, very much appreciated. And $1.7 million. I like that sound.
That's awesome.
Yes.
That's great.
Moving on to adoption of Resolution 2020-479, authorizing a waiver of competitive bidding requirements for the purchase of Zoll medical cardiac equipment. And will this be... Yes.
Oh, good. Sorry. First of all, I have to thank Angela and Sean. They held my hand through this whole process. So I appreciate their help in this as well. So 479 linked to the previous item with it's a request for a waiver of the bidding requirements to use a sole source purchasing agreement with Zoll. The requirements for the COVID compliant set of equipment that would be purchased with the grant, there's only two major manufacturers of this cardiac equipment, Zoll, and then what we currently use is Physio. Zoll is the only one that meets these requirements. And then with the time-sensitive nature of the grant award, when we have to have the monies received and spent, precludes us from using the traditional bidding process. So this resolution, staff's recommending pass to take advantage of the CARES Act funding.
Okay, and Angela, this fits in well with our current bid laws. Yes, it does. Good. Chair would entertain a motion to approve resolution 2020-479 to waive the competitive bidding requirements for the purchase of the Zoll cardiac monitor equipment.
Mr. Chair, I move to resolution 2020-479.
Okay, there's a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Commissioner Anderson, thank you. There is a second. Discussion. Hearing none, we'll move forward with the vote. Let's start with Commissioner Grisco.
Aye.
Aye. Commissioner Anderson.
Aye.
Commissioner Kester.
That would be an aye.
Okay, and Commissioner Pearson is an aye. Thank you. We have zero unfinished business. And again, public comment, please join us at www.spokanevalleyfire.com. prior to 2 o'clock, if you would like to make comments or make thoughts or suggestions to the Board of Commissioners or the administrators, we would welcome that. Just a reminder, we are now on Zoom, so we are now doing it through our website. Announcement for our next meeting will be Monday, November 23rd, 2000, 4 o'clock p.m. Via Zoom. And we welcome everyone to join us. And with that, the chair would entertain a motion to close this meeting.
So moved.
Okay, Commissioner Anderson, second.
Second.
Second. Commissioner Kester had his hand up, and all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you very much. You have a great evening and a great week. Thank you very
much.
Thanks,
everybody. Appreciate it. Thank you. Thanks, Chief.
You guys. Thank you very much.